Okay. You know, we are going to have a teacher here. The teacher who acted and the heroine of Kutram Kadival here for you to lead you through this exercise. Radhika, I know her for past 3 years. She's a wonderful head, so that Bernd can give some more information. Thank you.
Hi, thanks Ethan for embarrassing me. I'm going to ask all of you to stand up. You just had your lunch, I know, but
yes.
Let's lighten ourselves up a little. Just make sure you've pushed your chair behind you a little bit so that you give yourself a tiny square of space. Yes? Okay. You might not all be able to see me, so I'll just climb up here. Keep your feet parallel to each other. If you want, you can do it barefoot. It's more comfortable tightly. Feet parallel to each other. Make a V. And again, shift. Hands to the side of your body. So now, inhale. And exhale. As you inhale, feel the breath fill your stomach. It's already full with food, I know, but you know, just try to fill it with the oxygen, and then as you exhale, let your stomach just fall down. Okay? Inhale and exhale. Inhale and exhale. Inhale and exhale. Now inhale, and as you exhale, push your head, as in pull it towards your right. And keep breathing. Feel the stretch. Exhale, come back to center. Opposite side. Remember to keep breathing and feel the stretch. And as you exhale, come back up. Now the other thing that I'm going to ask you to do is take your right hand, put it at the back of your head, like here. And you're pulling your head towards your armpit. It's almost like, what if you were to sniff your armpit? How would you sniff your armpit? So you have to go down. Try smelling your armpit. So that's how you need to go down. Feel the stretch, keep breathing. Relax and come back to center. Repeat in the opposite direction. Relax and come back to center. This is called the cell phone muscle stretch. Apparently, like, you know, if you're on the phone for a long time, you tend to stress the muscle in the back of your neck here. With your shoulders, try to rotate them backwards. Hold on for support if you need it. Like this. Rotate backwards. Relax towards the front. Relax. Hands to the front. Take your left hand and do this. To the bottom. Relax. Opposite hand. Relax. Make fists. Rotate inwards. Outwards. Drop down. Hold on to your hips. Make sure your feet are parallel and slightly apart. Yeah. And now rotate. Make big circles. Relax. Opposite direction. Don't be shy.
It's okay.
Now your knees. Keep your feet together. Hold on to your knees. And slowly rotate. Opposite direction. Relax. Now with your feet, put one foot forward and stretch like this on the floor. Relax to the front.
Toe has to be stretched forward.
Yeah. Relax. Outwards, like this. Outwards. If everyone cannot see me, like this. Relax. Inwards. It's a little tricky. Relax. The other foot. Up. Relax, down, relax, outwards, relax, inwards, relax. Now slowly trot in the same place that you're standing, trot gently, gently, very gently. Like a really lazy horse. Slowly increase your pace. Shake your hands. Lift your hand up. Fall down. And hang like an elephant.
Thank you. I'm not sure whether I was to be looked at as being so elegant as you were. But everybody else was. Frieda? Your computer again excluded me from. So, I thought we from the contents, the next step would be talking about teams. But I thought we switch to another era and go back to teams later. And this, my suggestion is to switch to narrative approaches. And this is saying something about intuition. And this is about the concept I have developed about the background images and how to use dialogue with background images to understand which kind of situations are meaningful to me in order to develop criteria which professional careers are meaningful to me. And also, it has to be activated. The Ansichts. And then
is this the right one? Because you have several or
no, not team. That's the other one. That's this one. Okay. And you also can use dialogue between inner images and images of organizations to check for matching. Is my soul and what the pictures of the organization are and the picture of my development are, is it still together? Is it more approaching or is it more dividing? So that's a narrative approach to check matching between people and organizations. And I will do a guided imagery on that and invite you then to share your images and give you a schema question for that. And in the end, I will introduce you briefly into the theater metaphor, how we use that to analyze personality and how we use that to talk about reality creating. And this will be, I guess, until coffee time. And later on, maybe we go back to team and then we decide whether I do another demonstration or we go to one of the other topics like leadership or so. So does this sound right as a program?
Yes.
Good. This is a famous German coach who wrote the first book about coaching. It's not him personally, as you can see. We had a conference on inner images, and everybody was invited to bring a photograph or a picture. He somehow is identifying with, and he brought this. And I said, I don't know how it comes. All my colleagues have famous companies and high-level contracts, and they have the best stages to show off. And I always somehow come to companies who are at the very beginning, who where people I work with are somehow dry and have to be watered, and I work a lot to start new cultures. I don't know why this happens, but when you look at the picture he brought with him, so somehow this is a kind of identity he has. And certainly some people had the idea to tell him what he should do, that he can also go to the other companies and to the other stages. But it was obviously that his soul was not interested in that. And this is a picture that gives us an intuitive understanding of parts of his soul, where his soul feels at home. I briefly give you my understanding of soul. You cannot define it scientifically, that's clear. When I want to understand what is the nature of my soul, then I go to my diary where I write down all the pictures that come to my mind and came to my mind over the years. I have a picture about the soul like a fisher net. And you only see the air-filled balloons at which the fisher net is hanging, but you never know how big the fisher net is. But the nature of the net, about the nature of the net, you don't know anything too. But you can intuitively understand something about it by what is hanging in that net. And we all had millions of situations and images coming to our mind, and for some reason, some stayed with us, and 99% left us again. And I think the Americans say it takes one to know one. So what stays with me, whether I like it or not, something tells me about the nature of this, of my fisher net. And this is why when I want to dialogue with my soul, it's a good idea to dialogue with the images that have been caught by that. And it says something about a person. For example, there must be some reason that the only image that is left from the whole Vietnam War discussion in my soul is a sentence in the newspaper where there was written, Ho Chi Minh always sewed his jacket himself when it was broken. Also, he was the state leader. So what does this tell about me, that this is the only thing I remember from all these stories? So studying what is in yourself concerning specific focuses gives you an idea, gives you an opportunity to dialogue with the images of your soul concerning this idea. And this is a basic thinking about working with inner images. So the narrative approach is about intuition. I will talk about this soon. Background images I have just mentioned. Dreams. I work a lot with dreams. I have a Jungian education, and I wrote a book on systemic dream work. It's only in German, unfortunately. To show how dream work can be used to build up group communication culture. It's not so important the content of the dream. It's more important that by dialoguing with dreams, you create a specific sphere of communication within groups and say open up for somehow dialoguing with their souls while they are working within their professional roles. And this is the use of it. And I certainly, as you have experienced already, work with guided imagery. I always did in these 40 years. This going to back to a TA teacher when I first time was on a TA conference in 1976. I was at a workshop of Bill Holloway. And he did a guided imagery. You are at the edge of a wood and you hear some noises and something is coming closer and closer and closer, and now it appears. What is it? I don't remember the content, but immediately I knew this is what I will do. This will be part of my professional skills. I work a lot with metaphors. I've studied with Milton Erickson, as you told you, and I've taught NLP for years, and storytelling. And we often use, even in professional training, I will not outline this here now, I only take a part of it, but we train our professionals to put real-life situations, which are, if you look at it closely, narratives. It's not objective. And you may have the experience that you have discussed the same situations with different team members, and you wouldn't believe that this was the same situation. They are in completely different films. So every situation is a narrative, and every interpretation of a situation is a story about a story about a story about a story. So we train our professionals, for example, to bring in a supervision situation and then have the partner transform that into a metaphorical kind of telling. So we have now here five CEOs, and this person may transform it into have five elements, being at a lake together, and so on. So we learn to define elements, define key issues, and define processes to transform a reality from one stage to another stage. And this is a training in not sticking to the reality of expression of patterns only on one stage. And this can very often, as you may know and already work with, help you to get distance from a situation. So on the metaphorical level, they might much more easily talk about and get insights, because it's away from usual patterns of fighting. And we teach our professionals to develop from the situation brought in to transform it in what we call, and the NLP people call it, a matching metaphor. So on another stage with other figures, it's telling the same kind of stories, describing the same kind of situations than in real life. And from that we invite people to develop a leading story, a developing story. So if this story on this other level will change into something useful, how will it change there? And many professionals think, oh, I can't do that. This is not my language. And then we help them just to do it. And some are good in constructing these other stories, and some are not good in that. Some become good when they start to tell the story, because then the story, especially the leading story, the developing story, includes elements of ideas of their soul, how the story could develop in a good way without their front brain knows about it. So it's also a dialogue between them and their soul about ideas about development of their client's world. And many are so astonished what they can do and what they never believed that is part of their repertoire. Or some had put this only in telling goodnight stories to their children and never thought of using this capacity to develop designs for professional or organizational development. So this is part of our training to do so. This was creating metaphors and storytelling. We are doing now only the first two parts. Intuition. And this is also my TA tradition, because the founder of TA, Eric Byrne, started with studies on intuition. So I refer also to his definitions, and he refers to Aristotle, and I guess it's much older. So one thing is, an intuition is a knowledge about something without we know how we know. And usually without we know what we know. But if we watch ourselves, we act as if we knew. So when we learn to watch our action from a meta standpoint, we get an idea about our intuitions on the situation. So we learn about our diagnosis by watching ourselves already acting. In TA we call that social diagnosis. So we don't know how it works, and I don't believe even with a lot of brain research we will not know, at least not in my lifetime. And we know little what our intuitions are. But we act as if we knew, I already said. And intuitions have the function in evolution to organize immediate action. If you are 10,000 years ago, if you were at a spring and you drink and you raise your head and you see a wolf, you don't have time to sit down to make a design. How the situation is, a risk planning. you immediately do something. Either you, and there are thousands of informations coming together, deciding on your action without you know that you do all these analyses. You check whether you feel strong enough to run away, quick enough. You check how hungry the wolf is. You check how hard or soft the floor is, and up to the next tree, how deep or high the first branch is, and so on. If you would try to analyze all this with your front head, you will have been eaten up. Maybe some tried, but they didn't survive. So we are the children of those who decided intuitively. So my ideal, I come to that later, my ideal is that professionals usually act on intuition, but educated intuition. And the front brain is more for supervision, not for directing action.
But how safe is it to rely on intuition?
Pardon?
Intuition, we probably, like you rightly pointed out, is possibly a sum total of, you know, the genetic learning of the human civilization, I mean humankind, for the last 1,000-2,000 years, right from the days that we lived in, our forefathers used to live in jungles. That is how our intuitions were formed. Today, in a corporate environment, when the corporate environment itself is just about 100 years or 150 years old in many parts of the world, is it right to use intuition? Because that's a completely different genetic learning that we have got.
Yes.
Is it right to use intuition, therefore, in a corporate scenario?
Yes and no. It's not right to use intuitions as a content of specific areas that would not fit the context. But it makes sense to use the capacity to get into it. Intuitive judgments, because this is extremely quick in solving complex challenges, and is leading direct to action. And we all do that 90% of the time. The explanations we give are comments of our supervisor. They are not the explanations of, while directing your action. I come to that, the trained supervision. So you're bringing up the right questions. This is the last line here. Supervision, some people say intuition is wonderful, and they justify every nonsense with being intuitive. Certainly, the only quality of intuition is it's extremely quick. It can integrate data from very different logic spheres directly into action, what our front brain cannot do so quickly. And this is the real quality of intuition. But intuition can be mistaken and can be qualified or unqualified. So it's not a natural talent, what some people think. It's a competence, and it can be trained also as a competence. Certainly cannot be trained by bullet point teaching. It has to be trained like a session we do, as we do now. So we always have the discussion between, can you give a definition, or is it only a picture that is in your mind that is leading you? Bernd said, scientific methods which offer more security, so this definition by outlining limitations between one sphere and the other sphere. So scientific methods which offer more security and intuition, which opens up more options, are together the basis for creative action. So it doesn't make any sense in the discussion intuition versus thinking. It's a combination of both. Bernd had a lot of interesting considerations about intuition. There's a book out if you are interested more in Bernd stuff. It's a transactional analysis of intuition.
Intuition and ego states.
Pardon?
Intuition and ego states.
No, yes, this is one of the classical, but there was a gathering book in English out. Now, if you're interested, write me, I give you the details. Eric Bern, he was a psychoanalyst, and he lived almost 100 years ago. So he was much into psychoanalytic model, talking about the id in the person and how to get contact with intuitions of the id. And he always he discussed the question, how comes that intuition can be used for non-egoistic controlling purposes? What is necessary is that intuition is free, really creative, and what is necessary that intuition can be put into service for something or someone else than your ego interests. And he says, intuition can be limited by three major things. These are taboos. You have learned not to realize something or not to refer to something because of cultural traditions. You have desires that you are not allowed or not satisfied. So your intuition, if we personalize it, is always somehow looking, how can I get something for me, for my desires? And certainly a consultant or a psychotherapist or a partner who is not aware of his or her desire, but is very giving to you, I always get cautious. I want to know what the other person wants to get for his desires in our context. Then I feel safe. This is one argument for trust. I trust people. I know how they get what they need. I do not trust people that only want to give and do not make, I cannot understand what they get out of it. And it's fierce. This is, so far, it's Eric Bern. And certainly this is the reason why we always said a good psychotherapist, and this is also true for a good consultant or a good manager, can open up all his intuition for his task and for contributing when he's not under taboos too much and when his desires are clear or fulfilled somehow, or he knows where the desires are and can locate his desires in private worlds and not put it into the professional world, for example. I added to these limitations 3 points. I think Bern was a psychoanalyst. This is why he was a lot in motivation. But my experience is that habits are much more limiting intuition for something new than these classical three. So
example, sir.
For example, I have the intuition. My wife is might be it now a good moment to say something nice to my wife.
You are safe now.
But in my family, you usually sit still and don't open your mind. You might think it, but you will not tell it. And so most of the time, my habits are stronger than my intuitive knowledge that I should speak out loud something now. And this is not taboo, this is not desire, this is not fear, it's just habitual. And the role of being caught in habits is totally underestimated in the fixations of culture. So even if everybody is motivated, competent, and all this into building up a new culture, you still have to count on millions of habits that without anybody wants it, will bring you back into the old patterns. This is why to build up a culture, you should especially be careful in the beginning, and you should for a long time exercise the new patterns in order to build up new habits. And nobody can build up new cultures with controlling everything anew. So we have to build up new habits, and this is why in our training we have a specific range of learning approaches, and we do say them over and over again. So after a while it's a new habit, and everybody who's trained with us has a terminology that is habitual, has an understanding of some roles that is habitual, and has some procedures that become habitual. So they can just use their new habitual culture elements to turn to the real new things. If you change all the time things, then people are totally occupied with controlling behavior, and they have not the capacity really to do something new. And this is important, for example, also for companies. Companies who every year set up a new change process and think they can invent everything anew, they are incapacitating themselves. So I love habits, but habits, because they have a strong power to keep up with cultures, this is why you have to to regard habits as a major element of changing cultures. So, and in the professional region, to have the right intuitions, you need competence, you need knowledge. And if you don't have the knowledge, then you cannot be professionally, competently intuitive. This is why intuition without relevant knowledge in the field for which you want to develop the intuition is not sufficient. And you cannot exchange competence by intuition. And limitations to intuition are also a lack of cultural support. When you come out with images you have, you say, I don't know why, but this is how I feel, or this is an image that's coming up to my mind. And the culture is, can you prove that? No, I cannot prove it. Then don't bring up such hypotheses. Then it's a lack of cultural support, and you cannot use to bring these contents of the intuitions on the table. And maybe more qualifying time. They might be not qualified enough, but if you can't talk about them, you cannot qualify them. You cannot learn or have better intuitions, or bring these intuitions on the right level, or integrating these kind of intuitions in the right role, or understand that these intuitions that come up right now are not fitting to my role, what I can act on. So I learn to have the right intuitions, and this is part of professional training, and it's getting automated. automized. So this is what I just said. Professional intuition must be trained and must become focused according to what sphere is relevant and for which professional purposes it's needed. And this comes out of my discussion with my history as a psychotherapist. So as a psychotherapist, I was trained in intuitively understanding there's a game going on, or there's a script issue, or there might be a former age. I was brilliant in having pictures about at what age was an important former situation for the actual behavior. And I thought, this is omnipotent. But then I learned this is an intuition psychotherapist who wants to work with biography in a specific style. It's wonderful. But for an organizational consultant, this person should, if he has such kind of intuitions, put them aside and find new intuitions. For example, this behavior I can relate to role structures of companies I know already. Yeah, that's another background I'm referring to, focusing on the foreground. It's not the background of individual, of biography of the individual. Also, I could find something plausible there. There are thousands of plausibilities. That something is plausible doesn't mean it's right. So I learned to have different intuitions. I learned to relate behavior to roles, to frame of references, to team dynamics, to fields of society, and total other backgrounds. And this is an intuition that can be adopted and trained, and this is not coming from the ancient time. So this is referring to your question. And so we cannot discuss about adequate ways to be intuitive without understanding in what roles, what professions, for what purposes, in what field of society somebody works. And because all of us work in different fields, we have to develop different departments also for our intuition and learn to activate the intuitions appropriate to the departments and to the roles we work on. So this is, you can use the triangle we already had, also certainly for intuitions. And because as a psychotherapist, we always had some plausible intuitions, we thought it always must go this way to explain a situation. And I changed that. But many of my psychotherapeutic colleagues don't like it. They think this relationship to biography and to my intuitions I have learned around biographical work, they are so plausible that it doesn't make sense to focus on something else.
Sir, so, yeah. Can I share my experience?
Yes. Where's my microphone?
So, regarding intuitions, I would like to share my real life experience. In the year 1991, I decided to travel from Erode to Karur by the bus called Kamadeno, because at Karur I want to meet some distributor. I fixed the time that I told that I am coming this so-and-so by bus. So you don't close your shop. I will be coming to your shop. Then I sat inside the bus. I was very uncomfortable. I could not sit. I changed the seat here and there and all. There was a big argument within myself. Some of my part says don't travel by this bus. But intellectually, I was adamant that I want to go by this bus itself so that I can meet out my commitment. And finally, I do not know how I got out of the bus. When the bus leaves the bus stand, I got out of the bus. That time that Iran was there, then there was a lot of problem for petrol and all. So after that, after half an hour, I boarded that another bus. En route, I saw that bus directly have the collision with lorry. That bus is completely with full flames. If I might have traveled by that bus, I might have died that day itself. Can I call it as my intuition prevented me?
Yes. And this is a different part of the sphere of intuitions. But the world is full of stories like this, and we don't know how to explain that. What we can do is build up a culture where you have space to listen to these kind of intuitions, but also a culture that learns whether they becomes true or not. Otherwise, it becomes a magical thing, because you might have thousands of intuitions, and one got true, and then you think, oh, I'm an intuitive person, and you forget about the 999 that didn't have any relevance to reality. So. But certainly, as a Jungian-oriented professional, I agree to the notion of synchronicity. So there are relationships between things in the world and events that are not defined by time order and not defined by cause and effect. The only thing what really brings them together is a meaning. So that's it. But usually, this is a philosophical concept. We refer to it, but you cannot use it for professional training directly.
But which are the times we need to avoid intuition? This is not relevant to use the intuition here.
So here.
Not in the organization context, I'm telling you. So in our day-to-day situations or the issues what we are handling,
it's very important that you use intuition.
At some points, intuition will be embedded in our decisions. Sometimes it may not be. So we will not have that awareness whether we are doing it with intuition or not, actually. And how do we see this relevancy or not relevancy of intuition in day-to-day?
I believe that in most complex self-control issues, intuition is involved anyway. So many informations you use and work on, you are not aware of it. you don't know how it works, and you do not know what is the result of your intuition. But when you watch yourself, you can see, oh, I'm cautious with this with a boss today, and I was not cautious with the boss yesterday. When I watch my own behavior, what might be the intuition I have about the possible outcome discussing with him? And then, and this is what we learn in TA and in other professional approaches, to watch our behavior and come from this behavior back to what we probably had as an intuition. And then we can check whether the intuition was right. So that we learn on the correctness of intuition and of the importance. Maybe I grasp something of the boss what was true but irrelevant. I did not take in account that he is sovereign enough, that even he has some trouble with his wife, what I somehow sensed, he is clear about his role and the principles of controlling himself, that it will not bother our discussion. So you have to specify and train your intuition on that. And if you, by supervision, several times you go through it, then it sinks down into your intuition. Next time, you know immediately the right dimension of it without thinking about it. So your intuition gets better.
Sir, is it possible to train the intuition?
That's what I just said. That's the way you train intuition.
Yes, go to the previous slide, sir, please.
It must be trained, and it can be trained. It cannot be trained like sports. It can be trained by creating a communication atmosphere in which you are become aware of your intuitions.
Once trained thinking, we are getting means it's not an intuition. It is
a. You would not call it trained.
Intuition comes without the knowledge of the subconscious mind or something like that. Something is saying that it may happen. So at the time it was happening. So we cannot predict that. So how it may be trained?
The only way I know you can train it, that you are aware what intuitions you have and what the behavioral consequences of the intuitions are. You dialogue with yourself to understand what you do. And intuition is always a judgment. And then you can bring this judgment into supervision, and you may find out you are right, but it's not the right place for it, for this kind of judgment. It's not relevant for this business you do together. Or you are right, but you have over-exaggerated it, or not enough taking it in account, and others tell you they have similar intuitions, and they support you on your supervisions. And through these rounds, the training of intuition happens, and your unconscious mind takes these lessons, and next time it's working without your attention, and it's better working than before without your attention.
Yeah, again, intuition, I want to share some of the things. When I was walking, sometimes morning something flashed my mind. Okay, today you prepare all those things. Then immediately I go and I'll inform my subordinates, you stop all the work, you do all the things. And finally, that day evening management asks whether you have done all the tasks. Everything will be ready. So many times my intuition helped me to save my skin. Really, it has happened in my life. So this I would like to share with you.
Yeah, wonderful. My intuition is immediately tying this together what you said before the lunch break. And I would wonder how this goes together. So somehow my intuition says there's a discrepancy. You should ask which kind, but we are not in a consultation situation, so I don't do it. But I tell you that I'm aware of my intuition. Also, I do not act on it.
Yes.
Yes.
One of the things that I find about the word use of the word intuition is currently we are pretty much using it almost like a label for many things.
Yeah.
In particular, there is this aura of mystery around it that surrounds it, and quite often what we mean, I mean, especially after going through the points that you outlined regarding intuition, it's more like thoughts arising out of unaware familiarity with something. So that sort of seems to summarize for me what you actually mean by the word intuition here. Would that be correct?
I'm not sure whether I understood your point, but I say you give you my definition and you compare with it. For me, intuition is a judgment on reality we are not aware of.
The one extra bit that I'm adding to that is that judgment is arising out of a familiarity with something about that reality that you are unaware of.
Yes, yeah, certainly. There's no wisdom, there's no competence that doesn't have something to do with your learning experience. Except maybe intuition of the possible, when we go into the Jungian area. This is a nose for what is possible, what does not have any relationship to your personal history. It comes from somewhere different. And you are right, we use the container label intuition for many different things. But this is true for coaching, leadership, organization, whatever. So this is why we need to have some examples to understand. The scientific definition is not so important. So I want to go to the background images. And I developed, yeah?
Intuition and
assumption. These are different logical categories. An assumption is usually very often based on intuition. Mm-hmm. And usually, if you are aware of your assumption, it's conscious intuition. If you're not aware of it, it's an unconscious intuition. So, this is what I wanted to say. It doesn't make.
Can you just give us some examples?
Assumption with consciousness, intuition unconsciously.
No. Don't try to build up categories that don't help us. See, this is what I said with definitions. We have such a rich storage of words, and they are not ordered in a logical way of any kind. They are scrambled into each other. So if you try really to define something with limitations, what is still intuition and what is then an assumption, and what is an assumption cannot be an intuition and vice versa, you are lost. Because this kind of describing something is just not useful. It doesn't help you to understand. I always go with definitions that help you to understand, not help you to be able to explain.
When I say I think, when I use these two words, I think,
yeah,
would you call that as intuition or assumption?
Should we go into this semantic discussion? Because we have the same problem with think. We have so often the idea, what do you think, what is thinking when you use the word thinking? Because the new neuroscience makes very clear there is no thinking without emotions, for example. And there are no emotions without referring to some kind of thinking, even, but maybe unconscious thinking. So it's connected somehow with intuition. When we try to find out, get clarity in these word systems, then we are lost. I would just not try it. I'm sorry. This is our scientific training. We are trained that we have the idea, we understand something better when we have a definition. But in 99% of the cases, it's just not true. But let me go, I would like to fight on that, but it's not our topic today, so let us go to the background images. I tell you the origin of my work with background images. I was a student counselor, it's 40 years ago. I was at the University of Heidelberg, and many students came to me with problems in studying, not getting their work done and all these things. And I had learned some counseling skills. I tried out, but it didn't work. Because there was a category of people, intuitively, I had the idea they are like puppets on a string where the strings are cut. They are lost somehow. It doesn't make sense try to fix them on a skill level. They somehow have to fix their strings again, what their life and what they should do and want to has a purpose for, what makes meaning or sense to her soul. And if that is somehow reconnected, then we can find out whether there are still problems on the skill level. And I'm sure you have, if you are a consultant or if you are a leader or a cooperation partner, you also have colleagues that you always try somehow to help them to get more competent on a skill level. And you do that because you don't know what to do else. But if you would be honest to yourself, it doesn't make meaning to you, and you do not know on which way is this person in his life. And this is where I had somehow the idea I have to, and this was when I was with Bill Holloway and the guided imagery and these things, this was in 1976. And I thought, I somehow have to help these people to reconnecting what has meaning for them before we can go further. And so I had four or five together in a small seminar, an experimental seminar, and I experimented with the first questions that came out to mind. When you were young, when you were a child, what was your idea what will be professionally when you will be grown up? And four or five boys said, train conductor. So I was not sure whether this answer will help me much further. But only one question further, the world got differentiated. I asked them, imagine your life as a train conductor is always running. And you have one situation, how is that? And the one says, the machine and me. Nobody knows this machine as well as I do. The other said, my train conductor colleague and me, two boys traveling around the world. The third says, all these people in the train, trust me. I will bring you safe at your destination. And the fourth one said, Orient Express. I am at the, how you call it, platform, and I greet all the illustre guests we have. So you immediately have a feeling of very different ideas about how the world, what would enjoy their soul, and it's so totally different. The one who is with his engine has to have a different situation as the one who is with his friend. And if you just, because both are train conductors, you exchange them, you can make both unhappy. The one who said Orient Express, he was a Romanistic student now in his 16th term. I said, how is your studying going? He said, not so much. And then a shining came into his eyes, but I have a good job to make my living. And I said, what is this job? He said, I am greeter in the Grand Hotel. And I guess immediately you can connect it with his image about what he will be one time. So it's very clear that this person has some, the quality of situations, no matter what the subject of studying is or everything, has something to do with being in a good uniform, have to do with important people, and contact is more important than content and all these things. So you immediately have an idea that it's necessary for this person to, in order to get a new motivation for his studying, get an idea how his studying will bring him forwards to life situations which have this kind of qualities. So, and from that on, I developed this method, and I developed the questionnaire, what I could not do here, but if I have a client or a manager, and I feel that this person is living a superficial life, cannot orient himself or herself because the dialogue with the qualities the soul is looking for is broken down. And then I use these kind of dialogues with these people, so just to gather images how they can make up their role or change their roles or their places of work, or what they do more and what they do less. I say, okay, family members. What is, when you think about your profession in a very loose way, and when you think at family members related to profession, who comes to your mind first? Pardon?
Family.
Extended family. Even maybe family members you never met personally. It may also be fictive family members. The images are important, not the real life history on that. The images are guiding you. And for example, I had one who said, this was my father, he was a professor, he was a bright up man, upright man, a clever man. He knew systems and logics and did everything. And from him, I earned a lot of talents, and this is what my company, my small company, is based on. But he had the problem that he was not interested in marketing, and he not even was motivated to hire somebody who knows marketing and whose heart is for marketing. So, and I tried a lot of things with him, and I said, I know all that, but it's still not interesting me. And then I said, okay, look, let's look for other family members. They don't have to have your sympathy. It only counts they are still in your heart, in your mind. Is there somebody else? And for a moment he looked puzzled, then he nodded his, shaked his head, and then he went on searching. He said, no, let's take this. I said, oh, no, this is... said, yeah, let's take it. It's Uncle Paul, a brother of my mother. He is a black sheep in our family. I said, oh, that's interesting. And this brother was a market seller, standing on a wooden box and selling bananas or whatever, and yelling loud and seeking attention and knowing how to interact with people so that they are ready to buy something. But he was the ugly duck in the family, in the mentality of the family, so that he have excluded this person from the gallery of the images he can take talents from. And so I invited him to make friends with this, and even if the family didn't like him, he has talents he can use. He doesn't have to be a marketing specialist on that level, but if he only looks down on that talent, he cannot learn from that talent. And so he learned to adopt these qualities, and finally he got quite good in marketing. And I would never have reached that only on a technical or skill level, because his soul understood that it's good, and he even had these resources in his family and images, but he had excluded them. And sometimes, especially because companies are developing into areas where you need talents you didn't have to have 30 years ago, people are just lacking images. Then invite them, who do you know who has these talents you want to have? And then I dialogue with this person to learn to adapt this person into the gallery of his own background images, so that the soul gets enriched on this level with his talents. So it's very clear that this is not something you can prove. This is narrative, but you can feel it's verseful. So that's a method that helps you to understand and create meaningful professional situations. For example, for talent search, it's important. As a different form of assessment. In my institute, if we hire a new person, we talk about the images of the soul. And then we get intuitive ideas whether these mythologies and images can go together, or whether there are different stories and we will not harmonize on that level. And you could save a lot of money in assessment when you would adopt methods like this. And I believe most decisions are taken on that basis without knowing and without control. It's somebody who is maybe not very well trained, somebody who is not really very well trained in intuition, finally takes intuitive decision, but gives a lot of declaration why this was right. And so the assessment centers have to give reasons, but not really prepare the decision.
And having one question.
Yeah.
So in organization context, by using these background images, by this kind of personal questions about family members or something, would not be possible, no? So because it will touch somewhere into his emotion, somebody doesn't want to disclose it. So how we need to handle these background images in organization?
Yeah, if you make clear that you will not go after the emotions, for example. This is, I have a very strict interview that is only eliciting the situation and the person and qualities of the situation, but not talking about the history, not talking about the emotional relationship, only bringing up these pictures. Then it's more possible. And family is not the only source. I forgot to mention the other ones. You also can say, did people from the milieu of your origin come to your mind?
Okay.
And there is the tailor at the corner, and I remember how wonderful it was sitting still in his tailor workshop and he's working. And I really long for having the opportunity to sit in silence and work and somebody is with me and not always have these loud and noisy things going on. For example, so then we can discuss. Okay, is this an image of your soul that stayed with you? What can we do that these qualities will have be more in your professional situation? Can you change your role? Can you change department? Can you change company? Whatever you can do. But now you know what you are looking for, and you also can use dreams. You can use literature to elicit all these background images. And then you go through it and in an interview, and then you do not interpret it much. You just invite dialogue. And then maybe you stop at the end and wait what people dream or what images that did not fall into place during the interview, they come after some days. And this is a very experimental and very intuitive way of dialoguing on that. But very often it's very enriching.
In organization context, again, using these background images and dreams, would be the possibility for managers and subordinates to do that, or through the consultant it can be done? Or who will initiate or who will intervene and do this process?
Yeah, usually I do it as an external consultant. And I ask him, I say, somehow I cannot orient myself what is really important to people here. And I know a method where you can think about and dialogue with it for a while. And it may not have any direct connection to our official professional work, but it may enrich us. And if you share the feelings that somehow you are lost, this is an opportunity to find new meaning. And then if they are ready for an experiment, you can do it with everybody. Because it's not a emotionally deep work. It's a meaning deep work, but it's not a loud emotional deep work. And it does not afford that people disclose their biography.
Is there any demo of this on any of your seminars or video recordings of this particular interviewing method?
On my English website, I have interviews that follow these instructions, and you can watch it, how people react. I decided not to do this one here, but do more the approach that is close to the organizational work. And this is what I explained to you briefly now, and then I invite you in the guided imagery and sharing. Is that okay? So many people have the experience that somehow they lose the connection of their soul to the organization they're working in or they're working for. Or they have difficulties to decide whether the matching on the meaning level is good or not good. And then if it's a process in time, then I invite them into a guided imagery. And this guided imagery is focusing on a specific organizations, because there could be many of that kind, so that they are focused on an organization or on a part of an organization, a department, or a specific customer, or whatever. And then I invite them to have an image of the of their own past, how they have the image of themselves in the present, and do they have an image of themselves in the future? So, a picture of myself, past, present, future, and then I focus on the organization. Do you have a picture about the organization? Past, present, future. And in the end, you have a gallery of 6 pictures. Some may have more or less, or one picture is not filled immediately, and then we can talk about what that means, but usually we have 6 pictures. And what you can, and it's important to be aware of the pictures that come up, because it's somehow of comment of your soul. And then you can sit together and one tells these pictures to somebody else, maybe not having any idea what that has to tell. And the answers only if we have this intuitive, meaning-oriented atmosphere, say, watch what images and what feelings and what judgments come up within them. And then they mirror what the reactions on these mirror pictures and the relationship to the pictures, the person who is telling the pictures, comes up within them, and just gives this as a mirroring without judging, without analyzing, without drawing any conclusion. And this enriches manifold relationships between intuitive understandings. And then we just leave it. All these methods are not oriented to a direct solution. They are stimulating a mental search process. And this is a guided imagery I wanted to offer you right now, and then sit together in groups, and then I will have instructions for what you do in the groups and leading questions for your, and I hope that you somehow follow the leading question. So some subgroups, if you are not used to it, to be very disciplined, they talk about anything. But I'm usually quite strict on that. I don't dare to do too much here, to be too strict. But it helps if you really follow the instruction and not talk what you always talk.
But would it be good to form the groups and then lead them to the
events? Yes, that's a good idea. Thank you.
Yeah, and it's good to split them because...
Yeah, break up into 3 and look for somebody you do not yet know too good. And then I do the guided imagery. Thank you. Okay. Each time we start against the trance induction, it will get easier. Most of the cases, sometimes it's not. You never know. Because we don't have the football, we have the dog. You may know the dog very well, but it is no guarantee that the dog will behave the way you expect, and even very experienced dompteurs have been eaten up by lions. So it's okay to find your own way into the state of being calm, breathing. You don't have to look at this now. This is for later, after the trance. And when I was with Milton Erickson, as soon he adopted this voice, I went away into trance. But this may be different with you, but it can be the same. You never know. But you can do it also very orderly, technically, by saying, you can watch your breath. Can watch a bit, be attentive to your body. And in most cases, people start to breathe deeper as soon as they watch their breath. and breathing deeper indicates to the body now it's relaxing time. And this may elicit a cause in sitting position and letting go. And you will certainly have some disturbances in the world outside. You might have hear voices, or you might hear the ventilation again. And you remember that the ventilation can lead you to the place where you can be very calm and very much reflecting in an intuitive way. You don't have to try hard in any way, because your soul knows which pictures might be interesting and offers you something. And sometimes it's not an optical image. Sometimes it's a sound, or it's a sentence, and you might have heard the roaring of the bicycle outside, or some coughing. All that is allowed to be, but you don't have to be attentive to it. And you might find some connection to the images from yesterday evening. And you might somehow follow some connection to the images from yesterday morning. Or beyond that, images that may fall into place that are important for you now for the announced exercise. And I don't know how deep you are in trance now, and whether this is the right way of trance for you. But it's okay. It's enough that you can dialogue with images. As I announced to you earlier, we will have a topic, and I will invite you to explore the relationship between you and an organization. And it's interesting which kind of organization will come to your mind. You would like to somehow check the matching with this organization over time. This might be an organization you work in, or might be an organization you work for, might be a deliverer or a customer. It can be a bigger organization, but usually it's easier to have a small unit, a team or a department or something like that. And probably more than one organization come to your mind. Take some moments to decide which one you will accept. And the other one say, respectfully, thank you for the offer, but I don't want to dialogue with you now and say goodbye for the moment. And with the organization you have chosen, just give yourself a moment to have pictures of situations and encounters with this organization. And it might be that now you have a clear relationship. This is the organization on the other side, and this is me here. And now we can see whether we find some pictures that help us to understand and compare and check the matching. We don't have to understand, we don't have to analyze. It's just enough if you find images and let us start with three images about you, one of the past, one of the present, and one of the future. So when you look at yourself in the past, I don't know what past is for you, maybe months, maybe years, I don't know. And then some kind of image comes up, maybe some situation or symbol or whatever. And as soon as you have found it, put it into the first frame, me and the past. And if you didn't find anything or you find more than one, just let it be the way it is right now. And now you can change your attention in the timeline to the present. What would be an image that says something about you now? And if you have found something, put it in the second frame, me and the present. And then we turn to the future. You certainly do not know what the future is, but you might have images, fantasies about the future. So in future, maybe in months, maybe in years, I don't know what future in this regard is for you. Something will have developed. And you might have an image on what will be then. And as soon if you have found such an image, put it in the third frame, me in the future. And let's have for a moment an overview over the three frames, me in the past, me in the present, and me in the future. and put it enough in your memories that you are aware of it when you tell later others, if you want to tell, you don't have to. Now I remind you to the organization you have chosen, and we have three empty frames, the organization in the past, the organization at present, and the organization in the future. So let's look into the past. Certainly, it's the organization in your experience. We do not expect that it's objective. It's your image, but it's okay. It's an image of an organization. So maybe a picture or a symbol or something is erasing concerning the organization and the past. And as soon as you found it, put it in the first frame. The organization and the past. Then we go to the present. How is that organization mirrored by you today? And do you have any image that is telling us how you perceive the organization today? And then put this image into the frame two, the organization at present. And then return to the future. Do you have any idea what this organization will be in future? And is there an image to it? And if you have found such an image, put it into frame three, the organization of the future. And now again, let's have a short overview over the three frames concerning the organization. Past, present, future. And whatever you experience, take it enough in your memory that you can tell it to the others when you want it later. And this is the point. We start our way back to the day consciousness and do it at a pace that you stay somehow in contact with your experiences from right now. But more and more, it's time to wake up and orient yourself in the outside world. This usually goes along with changes in breath, in breathing, changes in your body awareness, movements come, and after your time you need, you open your eyes, orient yourself here in the room. And be aware of your two partners sitting around you. And you will exchange with these two partners whatever you want to exchange from your experience now. This might be in the first place the six pictures. If you want comment on the process, it's okay too, but not only the process, if you have any pictures. And we do it always in the way that you do not discuss. It's only one is telling, and the others are listening and watching themselves, so as it's written here. You first, when you are telling, you say, what team is it, what kind of organization I was referring to. No long story, two sentences. And then talk to your partner about the images of yourself in relation to this team and organization. And you can either go me, present, past, future, and then organization, present, past, future, or you can go me, past, me, present, organization, present. That's up to you. And while you talk, your partner sit. So you are three now, this was written for two. Sit relaxed and are aware of their inner responses. So they dialogue with their own reactions and own intuitions. And you have time, let's say, 5 minutes just to tell your experiences. And the others have 5 minutes time to say something about their reaction. When you hear me often say, while I listen to you, it comes to my mind. So this kind of comments. And do not discuss. Do not say, oh yeah, he's saying something, I see it very differently. And no, just as you do just the pictures one beside one, you do the mirroring one beside one, and the one who told his experiences just listens and doesn't have to react to anything. It's a gathering of images and ideas and reflections, not more. And because you are three, you do this now for 30 minutes. 5 minutes telling, 5 minutes reactions. And you decide who is A, B, C, and one should look after the time, because otherwise C will not have time. Please be disciplined and take responsibly about justly sharing your time. 10 minutes for each one, 5 minutes telling, 5 minutes reactions from the other two, and only gathering, nothing else. So please start.